OpenAI had their iPhone moment this week, a moment that we will remember as the pivot point, where AI became unavoidable in the average person's daily life.
Aw, I see. I love ChatGPT. That's so sweet of you.
Their latest flagship model is a real-time, multimodal model, combining vision, memory, voice synthesis, and emotional understanding into a single, groundbreaking tool. But amidst the excitement of realizing her...
Hello, I'm here.
Oh. A significant piece of news flew under the radar. The resignation of Ilya Sutskever, Jan Leike, and other high-profile people from the OpenAI superalignment team. The team responsible for making sure that AI doesn't murder us all in the future. There's been a shift at OpenAI, a shift away from its founding principles of transparency and collaboration. And the consequences of this shift reach far beyond the borders of the company. But to really understand the danger here, we need to dive into GPT-4o's capabilities and why OpenAI chose this moment to release this model for free. We didn't arrive at this moment in a vacuum. Up until the release of GPT-4 a year ago, Google was the undisputed leader in AI capabilities. A lot has changed since then, but the underlying reality of the situation remains the same. Google has access to vastly more compute and data resources, the lifeblood of these AI models. If you're Sam Altman at the helm of the top AGI lab in the world, it's easy to see just how fragile OpenAI's lead is. In this context, OpenAI's move to release GPT-4o for free looks more like a strategic gambit to outmaneuver Google's massive data and compute advantage.
It's so important to us to have a product that we can make freely available and broadly available to everyone.
Looking past the compute resources, open source models have shown us just how powerful we can get these models by focusing on the data. To illustrate this point, let's look at how traditional software is built and compare it to AI model development. In traditional software, a human coder thinks about a problem and develops an algorithm to solve it. They then write code to implement this algorithm. From there, the human-readable code is compiled into machine-readable code. The end result is a series of ones and zeros that computer hardware will be able to execute. That's all changed now. Humanity has effectively found a way to take any arbitrary pile of data and turn it into intelligence. To develop an AI model, we start with the data. We do a lot of work upfront to filter the data, massage the data, and really get it feeling good about itself. Once we have the data the way we want it, we tokenize the data into a machine-readable form and run transformations via specific algorithms into a set of model weights. The key point here is that humans aren't writing any of the code that actually executes at runtime. The largest lever we have in this pipeline when developing these models is the data. And now that we have access to advanced models like Claude, Gemini, and GPT-4o, they are helping us acquire and transform data at an even greater scale to build the next generation of models. The snake is starting to eat its own tail. Sam wrote a nice little blog post talking about how OpenAI is living up to its name by giving away access to its most advanced model for free. But we already know how Sam feels about OpenAI's openness.
I would definitely pick a different, speaking of going back with an Oracle, I'd pick a different name.
Given the situation OpenAI finds itself in, running low on data and compute resources, trying to hold on to their lead in this era-defining race to AGI, their moves start to take on a more self-preservation feeling. The attention economy that grew out of the last tech revolution should be our warning here. When you use something that is free on the internet, you are paying for it with much more than your money. In this case, OpenAI wants your data. It wants as much data as it can get. Companies all over the world right now are trying to figure out how to acquire more data and alchemize their current pile of data into a pile of gold. And that's why it's so frustrating to read Sam's post, the one that claims they're living up to their open name by giving away access to models. Sam, more than anyone else, knows how the proliferation of this technology will fundamentally change the attention economy, making what he's doing seem far less chivalrous. And believe it or not, it turns out that words actually mean things, and changing the definition of open to suit your own ends has consequences.
Words will always retain their power. Words offer the means to meaning, and for those who will listen, the enunciation of truth. And the truth is, there is something terribly wrong, isn't there?
The term open in OpenAI once stood for transparency and collective progress. It came from a nonprofit company whose mission it was to create safe AGI to benefit all of humanity. Now it feels more like a hollow echo of its former self as the company tightens its grip on proprietary technologies. Openness is ingrained in the DNA of the tech industry. Most of the software we interact with every day is either open source or built on top of open source technology. Over the last 40 years of computing history, countless developers have developed and shared code with each other for free in a global community of people building software to help themselves and each other. If you haven't been a part of the tech industry, this may seem really weird, but this culture of openness is a huge factor in what has fueled the digital revolution and meteoric transformation of our society. AI followed the same paradigm for a long time, with open research, open data, and open models, allowing researchers all over the world to participate in the development and safety evaluations of artificial intelligence. Not only does this mean we all get access to more capable models, but we also get the benefit of open criticism, improving the security and safety of these models. That's how we got to where we are today, by sharing and being open. But things have changed.
But open sourcing it? No, that's just sheer catastrophe. The whole notion of open sourcing, this was always the wrong approach, the wrong ideal.
When people are afraid of something, their natural reaction is to exert more control over that thing, to give them a false sense of power over it. Smarter than human machines are on the horizon, and that will have enormous consequences for the entire planet. The gravity of what we are building right now cannot be overstated. Ilya Sutskever, OpenAI's co-founder and former chief scientist, saw something last November, something that made him take drastic action to try and remove the man at the helm of his company. But the old adage applies here. If you come at the king, you best not miss. Ilya was placed in isolation after his failed coup and disappeared from the public spotlight.
Is he being held hostage in a secret nuclear facility?
No.
That is until last week, when he and the other leaders on the alignment and safety teams resigned, turning OpenAI's crowning moment into one where they are now running damage control. Ilya maintained the public niceties, choosing not to go into too much detail on the reasons for his decisions. But again, this may have more to do with self-preservation than anything else. OpenAI's new lack of openness extends far beyond their technology. Ever since the failed coup to oust Sam, NDAs and security controls have become much more strict. Sam has consolidated his power to the point where people who leave the company are barred from saying anything critical, lest they lose their vested shares, shares worth millions of dollars. That's why it was so surprising to read Jan Leike's comments after his departure as a leader on the superalignment team, in which he explicitly called out OpenAI's disinvestment in safety and alignment research and the need for much more transparency. OpenAI's excuse for hoarding their advanced models in the name of safety seems to be as hollow as their name. OpenAI is now a for-profit company run by a board handpicked by Sam. They have completely abandoned their roots of openness and altruism for what seems like profit-fueled motives. And as tired as this story is, absolute power corrupts absolutely. It doesn't have to be this way. The coup attempt on Sam failed, but it left a scar. a scar that is growing to define the man.
I think I'm like an extremely trusting person. I have always had a life philosophy of, you know, like, don't worry about all of the paranoia. Don't worry about the edge cases. You know, you get a little bit screwed in exchange for getting to live with your guard down. And this was so shocking to me. I was so caught off guard that it has definitely changed. And I really don't like this. It's definitely changed how I think about just like default trust of people and planning for the bad scenarios.
When we lose trust in each other, when we aren't willing to be open and vulnerable, that's when our actions devolve into these self-preservation games. And this energy leaks. It leaks into the culture of the company. So much so that the people who joined in the beginning, the people that joined for very different reasons, they begin to leave. This erosion of trust and the abandonment of core values in pursuit of rapid growth and profitability is a recurring pattern in the fast-paced, high-stakes culture of Silicon Valley. You grind hard, losing money for years with the aim of achieving an exit. And once the company is bought out or goes public, the core values that fueled the company in the past and the people that make the company up begin to change. The development of AI is too important, too impactful to leave to the whims of the Silicon Valley machine. We need free AI. Free as in freedom, not free as in beer. This means we need to go even further than companies like Meta, who are offering open weight models, which is great, but it doesn't go far enough. We need open weights, open algorithms, open research, and open data. That's how we avoid a P-doom scenario, not by hoarding what we have in fear, but by trusting each other and building this new world together. Even if that means we get hurt sometimes. The choices we make now will define our future. We can build a world where technology benefits all of humanity, if we can remember how we got here in the first place. There's much more to the story of what happened last November between Ilya and Sam. And if you want to dive into the details of that story, watch this video next.